Listening Library presents Porch Lies by Patricia McKissack. Read for you by Pamella DePella, Adenrele Ojo, and Mirron Willis. Author's note. Whippoorwills, lightning bugs, and homemade peach ice cream trigger memories of my childhood summers spent at my grandparents' house in Nashville, Tennessee. The squat white-framed house at 3706 Centennial, next to the Tennessee State University power plant, sat comfortably on the property as if it was resting in an easy chair. Looking at the house from a distance, I always imagined that the two side windows, the center door, and the sagging porch formed a big happy face, smiling a welcome to me when I rode my bicycle down the long front walk. Skipping up five steps placed me in my favorite spot, the porch swing. There, I could read for hours or listen to someone tell a story about sneaky foxes or things that went bump in the night. I spent a lot of time listening in those days. In the evenings, when dinner was done, the dishes washed, and the dish towels hung out to dry, my grandparents, Mama Frances and Daddy James, spent the rest of the evening on the porch. Sometimes, if there was a baseball game, Mama Frances hooked up the radio in the living room window so we could listen to the play-by-play in the cool. We were loyal fans of the Brooklyn Dodgers, the first major league team to sign a black player, Jackie Robinson. We all cheered loudly each time Jackie came to bat, and we never missed a game. Sometimes there was a Marian Anderson or a Mahalia Jackson concert on, and while my grandmother listened, my grandfather and I were forbidden to say a word. "Shh," Mama Frances whispered, as if she was actually in Carnegie Hall and didn't want us to disturb anyone. "Listen," she told me, "and remember the sound of greatness." On those hot summer evenings, it was not uncommon for family members, friends, and neighbors to drop by for a visit. Some were invited, and others just stopped when they saw us sitting out front. My grandmother always had a pitcher of lemonade or iced tea and homemade tea cakes prepared for all visitors. Some of these visitors loved to tell stories, or porch lies as we called them, tales of humor and exaggeration told to listeners of all ages gathered together on the porch. When the teller's eyes grew mischievously large and bright, and his or her hands became as animated as a puppeteer's, we knew that a porch lie was in the making. Mama Frances always welcomed us kids to join the circle of grown-ups, with the strict understanding that we were to remain unobtrusive. Somehow, we managed to sit still in spite of our excitement. The radio was shut off, and all we could hear was the melodic sound of a storyteller's voice. I was especially delighted when the story was a slickster trickster tale about some wily character who used his wits to outsmart his opponents. I like to think of each of these slicksters as a cross between a Mississippi bluesman and Br'er Rabbit, though there were a few women as well. And whether it was some fast or slow-talking, a well-dressed city slicker, or an innocent-looking country bumpkin, all were gifted with a silver tongue tarnished by an oily reputation. No matter how bad these characters seemed, however, they managed to charm their victims and disarm their critics with just enough humor to take the edge off their unscrupulousness. Among the many porch lies I heard, the most memorable were about Pete Bruce, a man my grandfather knew in the 1920s. Pete was sly and devilish, but always funny. Whenever we were unsure of ourselves or when our ever-changing world collided with our concepts of justice and honesty, Daddy James would summon up Pete Bruce. He used Pete Bruce as a vehicle to teach a value, to encourage us to think critically, or just to entertain us by putting a little joy in an otherwise gray day. And that is my intent, too. Although these stories contain the essence of truth, they are fiction from beginning to end. I have drawn from my grandfather's models of the slickster trickster character, and I have expanded the myths, legends, and historical figures who often appear in the African-American oral tradition and placed them in my own original Porch Lies. Smart and charming Mingo Cass, easygoing Link Murphy, and yes, even prim and proper Ms. Martha June are my creations. So now, let your own imagination take you to the front porch of your mind, much like the porch at my grandparents' house. Find a comfortable spot, pour yourself a glass of lemonade made with fresh lemons, and enjoy one of my Porch Lies, just as I savored the ones I heard years ago. Patricia C. McKissack, Chesterfield, Missouri, 2005. When Pete Bruce Came to Town. Dedicated to Daddy James, who introduced us to Pete Bruce at the old house on Centennial Boulevard in Nashville, Tennessee. Ms. Martha June was a person I thought incapable of telling a porch lie. I was wrong. Always prim and proper, she was a church-going woman who spoke in quiet, refined tones with her mouth pursed in the shape of a little O. She was never without a dainty pocket handkerchief tucked in her sleeve, which she gingerly used to dab perspiration from her brow. A woman of Ms. Martha June's qualities did not sweat. She owned a bakery that was known for having the best coconut cream pies in the world, same recipe her mother used and her mother before her. And no customer was more faithful than a wily character named Pete Bruce, about whom she loved to tell stories. He was considered the prince of confidencers, and the idea of Ms. Martha June having anything to do with the likes of him was about as odd as a fox and a hen striking up a friendship. Pete Bruce was the worst somebody who ever stood in shoes, Ms. Martha June always began in her quiet manner. But then she'd add quickly, "I'll be the first to admit, however, he could make me laugh in spite of myself, especially when he threw one of his million-dollar smiles my way." Here is the rest of the story, as she told it long ago on our front porch on a late summer night.
I was near about 10 years old when I first laid eyes on Pete Bruce. He was a full-fledged rascal, and I knew it. If you went by looks alone, Pete Bruce was pleasing enough. Had a nice grade of hair, wore it slipped back with Murray's hairdressing oil and water, had plum black skin, even darker eyes, and a devil-may-care swagger. As I recollect, he always loved big Stetson hats, flashy cars, and loud suits. Stood out. Pete Bruce liked that, standing out, being noticed and all. Mama sold coconut cream pies to passengers at the bus station back then, and her reputation as a super baker was known far and wide. Most people called her the pie lady. I helped Mom on weekends or when I wasn't in school, so folks start calling me Lil Pie. And a few people still call me Pie to this day. It was an ordinary Tuesday morning when Pete Bruce stepped off the bus. Hot? My goodness, it was hot as blue blazes. Yet I noticed that this man had on a suit, fresh and crisp, as if he had just taken it off the cleaning rack. How come he looked so neat when everybody else looked like they slept a week in their clothes? I wondered out loud. A sign of good material, said Mama, who was studying the stranger as a potential customer. We watched as he dabbed his brow with a perfectly folded white linen handkerchief. He checked the crease in his hat and placed it squarely on his head. Then he studied the surroundings, as if testing the wind, getting the lay of the land. Spying Mama and me, he picked up his carpet bag and started on over. The man had an ageless body. By the bounce in his step, he could have been 20, but the set of his brow told the story of a much older man. "Morning." He spoke real polite-like, flashing the biggest grin. Name's Pete Bruce. Them coconut cream pies? He asked Mama, examining the display she had arranged on the hood of our 28 Ford. Welcome to Masonville, Mama said cheerfully. This is my daughter, Martha June, and yes, sir, these are coconut cream pies made by none other than Frenchie Mae Bosley, yours truly. Mama extended her hand, and Pete Bruce took it and pumped it like a bellows. He grabbed mine and shook it, too, and I noticed how soft his was. This was not a man used to hard work. Pies do look good, he said, still holding that grin like an egg-stealing fox. Here, have a piece. Mama always let people taste a sliver of her sample pie. It was great for business, because not one person had ever taken a taste and not bought a whole one. Sometimes they bought two. Pete removed his hat the way a man does when entering a church or a funeral and clutched it to his chest. No, ma'am, he said ever so courteously. What's the matter? Mama said, sounding sympathetic. You got sugar? He shook his head, lowered his eyes, and leaned on one foot and then the other. No, ma'am, I ain't a diabetic, he sighed heavily. Well, what then? Mama was curious now. I mean no disrespect, Miss Frenchie, but there's a lady over in Steelville, Miss Opal Mary. She bakes the best cream pies in the world. He closed his eyes as if he was eating one right then. I have no doubt that your pie is delicious, but it just can't be as good as Miss Opal Mary's. Mama's back stiffened. How can you say that without having eaten mine? She replied curtly. Pete Bruce went back to shifting his weight from one foot to the other, eyes cast downward. I'm sure your pies are fine, ma'am, but I'd rather not disappoint the last memory I have of Ms. Opal Mary's rich, creamy, oh, so sweet coconut cream pie. Mama was beside herself. I assure you, young man, there is no way in the world you would be disappointed if you ate a slice of my pie. I can't be sure, Pete said, looking like it made him sad to say it. Quickly, Mama cut a small wedge from her sample pie. She shoved it at Pete Bruce. Slowly, as if it pained him to do so, he put the whole thing in his mouth and chewed on it with his eyes closed. He moaned. Well, sir, said Mama confidently, tell me the truth. Wasn't that the best thing you've ever put in your mouth? Pete Bruce opened his eyes and shook his head. I wish I could say, but what? Pete shrugged. I'm confused. It's hard to tell whose is better, yours or Miss Opal Mary's. I bet, said Mama, your taste buds are mighty confused if you can't tell the difference between my pie and that other what's her name? Mama cut an even larger piece. Then offering Pete a seat on the running board of her car, she handed it to him. She watched him bite into the creamy filling and flaky crust and chew it slowly. Mama, I whispered, trying to warn her, you're not going to let him get away with... Hush, Mama said, dismissing me with a wave. Pete Bruce swallowed and smacked his lips. Well, he said, licking his fingers, I must say, Ms. Frenchie, that was mighty good, but don't say it, don't you say it, Mama held up a warning hand. She seemed almost desperate. Here, have one more slice. Then she reached inside her apron for some money and sent me over to the store to get a pint of milk. Mama, I tried to protest, but she shot me a look that said, you better do it or else. So I did. As I headed towards the grocery store, I heard Mama say, a little milk will bring out the flavor, immediately adding, not that my pie needs any help. Soon as I was back, Mama shoved another huge slice at Pete Bruce, along with a whole bottle of milk. He polished it off in no time flat. Then Pete gave Mama one of those special smiles. Ma'am, I do believe you got Ms. Opal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.